Hi, I'm Kathleen Hirsch, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, vote411.org, before you mark your ballot. Today we have Wlnsvey, Campos, candidate for House District 28. Welcome, Wlnsvey.
Hi, good morning, thank you.
Tell us about your background and why you're running for the Oregon House.
So I work as the case manager for Family Promise of Beaverton. It's a transitional housing program that helps families experiencing homelessness get into housing. And it's the work that I do that was essentially the catalyst for me making the decision to run. I had a day at work where I had one too many conversations with families about the lack of resources and solutions for them in the area. And I started the day out on the phone call with somebody who by the end of the phone call knew that they were going to be sleeping outside. And I ended the day with a mom breaking down in tears in front of me, asking me how she was supposed to put a roof over her children's head when she works 40 hours a week but only makes minimum wage. And she laid out what those numbers meant. That meant that she made a little over $1,700 after taxes, and a two-bedroom, which is what she was looking for, last year averaged a little over $1,300. And so I sat at my desk thinking, what we need is change at a policy level. We need people that are on the front lines of the most pressing issues, but we also need people who have diverse lived experiences, like those that I bring as somebody who grew up in a low-income household in rural Oregon. From the age of 8 until I left for college, my family lived in a motel room because that's what we could afford. And there were times in my life we had to go to the public library restroom to literally roll sheets of toilet paper to take home so that we could save $8 that week and put it towards bills. And so I'm ready to get in the building and fight for families like mine, fight for working families, and be an advocate for our community.
Thank you. The wildfires that have devastated Oregon, as well as recent media reports, have underscored the need for a deep look at forest management in Oregon, including an increase in sustainable harvesting and better oversight of harvesting done on private lands by outside interests. What are your thoughts on this issue, and what legislative action, if any, is needed?
So, certainly, wildfires are at the forefront of our minds. There's so much that needs to be addressed there, including the forest management piece of it. I know there has been in the past controlled burning of lands that has helped with decreasing the land that is so easily caught up in the wildfires. And so I think we need to take a look at the way in which lands were, the way in which the controlled burning has been done before, and look at these forest management practices to make sure that we're decreasing wildfires in the area. But the other big piece of it is addressing climate change. It has been one of my top priorities on the campaign. Because you know, we're looking at a pandemic right now, but the next big thing that we're looking at facing is climate change. And so there are a number of different issues that I talk about on the campaign trail. I talk about healthcare, I talk about housing, but I can't talk about what housing is going to look like in 50 years if we're not sure what the world, what the earth is going to look like for ourselves, for our children, for our grandchildren. So we need to make sure that we're forward thinking in the legislation that we pass to make sure that we're tackling climate change in the way in which it needs to. And I have been a strong advocate for an Oregon Green New Deal, which essentially looks at creating high-wage jobs in the transition to clean energy, as well as making sure that we're equitable in the legislation that we pass.
Thank you. The pandemic has revealed the urgency of replacing antiquated government computer systems and also making internet access available to the 94,000 Oregonians who lack any wired internet options. Can you comment on what legislators should do to address this need?
Absolutely. So first of all, we need to invest in that infrastructure. We have tons of people right now who have not received their first unemployment check, first of all. And that is unacceptable. It is outrageous. And it certainly has us thinking, you know, what is going on with the infrastructure that exists right now that is part of creating this delay. And so we need to make smart investments in technology, in our infrastructure, to make sure that it's updated and modern and can deal with emergencies particularly. We need to make sure that we're doing a lot of emergency planning and management in advance of these emergencies actually happening. And the other piece of what you're talking about with regards to internet access, I firmly believe that internet should be a public utility. Working as a case manager, I have seen the direct impacts of being unable to access internet. Certainly, it's been fantastic that schools have provided that they've provided Wi-Fi routers, for example, to students who have been in need. But I myself grew up in a location where we did not have Wi-Fi. And so I remember having to do most of my homework at the public library. And sometimes that meant, you know, the public library parking lot late at night if it was a project that, you know, maybe I ran late on and had to do in the late hours of the night. So we need to make sure that it is a public utility and that everybody can access it, whether you're low income or whether you are in rural Oregon, which is one of those places that I know lacks internet access.
Passing a balanced budget in light of the coronavirus pandemic and unprecedented wildfires will be a very challenging task in the coming session. If elected, what will your guiding principles as you make difficult budgetary choices?
Yes, so my guiding principles will be in making sure that we're serving the community, that we are making sure to prioritize our underserved communities in particular, who are often left out when we take the budget into consideration. Certainly the narrative right now around the 2021 budget is cuts. And I think we need to be reframing that narrative and looking more towards how do we increase revenue. But as we talk about cuts, we want to make sure that we are protecting Medicaid, that we're protecting the Oregon Health Plan, that we're protecting services that disproportionately affect communities of color, for example, or those who are from low-income backgrounds. So that's what I will be looking at the end of the day with the budget. But I really think that we should be reframing it towards talking about how do we increase revenue in Oregon rather than having to cut a number of different services. And the other piece of it is that I think we need to be smart about looking at the budget. For example, we've seen before how there have been cuts that seemed like they were the right thing to do in the moment, and years later caused more devastation, caused more debt because there wasn't that forward thinking. So as we're looking at the budget, we need to be forward thinking about it.
Thank you. Oregon's suicide rate and incidents of domestic violence have risen sharply during the coronavirus epidemic, and gun purchases have skyrocketed. What legislative steps, if any, would you support to encourage gun safety and prevent the escalation of gun violence?
Absolutely. So as somebody who grew up in rural Oregon, I'm certainly familiar with gun owners, and I know that a lot of gun owners believe in things like safe storage, which was something that was talked about in the last long session, and is something that I am certainly an advocate for. I know that gun owners want to be responsible, and you know, we need to make sure that guns are not accessible for, say, a child. we've seen it happen before, and so I will be an advocate for safe storage laws. I will also be an advocate for making sure that we have background checks. We want to make sure that guns aren't landing in the wrong hands. And again, at the end of the day, I know that gun owners they want to be responsible with their gun usage. Those who, you know, have permits and such have gone through these processes. And so we need to make sure that we're keeping the public safe, that we're keeping children safe, that we're also investing in mental health services is the other piece of that. We're certainly living through a time right now that is challenging in a number of different ways. As you noted, we've seen suicide rates go up, and so we need to make sure that we are investing in mental health services for those who need it.
Final question. Why should voters choose you over your opponents?
So I will note that I have years of civic engagement, public engagement in the community. I've taken on a number of different volunteer opportunities over the years. I was proud to have participated in a forum the other day and talked to folks about my vision. And I will make sure that I am accessible, that I am doing the outreach into the community, because at the end of the day, you are a representative of where you are elected. It says it in the title, right? State representative. And so I will make sure to be a representative of the community by having that public input, by reaching out to the community. And I bring a number of different perspectives in the legislature that we currently lacked, whether that's somebody who has quite a bit of lived experience as someone who grew up in a low-income background, as someone who comes from a community of color. But I also am actively engaged in the community in a way in which we don't always see in legislators or candidates. Working as a case manager, I am on the ground seeing the issues that we talk about. To me, policy issues are not abstract problems. They're things that I have lived, and they're things that I am now helping families in our community navigate every single day.
Wlnsvey Campos, thank you so much for talking with us today. And voters, don't forget to visit vote411.org for complete candidate and ballot measure information. Thank you.